Jenny McCarthy Show.
Oh! Welcome back to the Jenny McCarthy Show. I'm Jenny McCarthy Wahlberg. You guys have fell in love with him years ago and continue to, and now you're going to fall in love with him even more. He wrote an amazing book that I know many moms can relate to. Life to the Extreme, How a Chaotic Kid Became America's Favorite Carpenter, Ty Pennington. Welcome to my show.
Thanks for having me.
I'm so grateful that you wrote a book like this because, especially in today's day and age, and I know this, the amount of kids being diagnosed with ADD, ADHD, autism, chronic illness, you name it, there's something is going on. Well, that's a different story. But I always wondered, what does it feel like to have... How would you describe what it feels like as a kid to have ADHD?
Well, in the book, there's an interesting way that I describe it. For anyone who like has ADHD, I did this actually on a talk show once too. And so it's basically, imagine playing ping pong with somebody, but then having to recite the alphabet backwards because your brain, you can't end up doing either one because your brain like starts to freak out because it's trying to focus on the alphabet, but then you're also trying to hit a ball over a net.
That's a good analogy.
And like, because you're literally trying to solve like 16 different puzzles and try and communicate at the same time, but... Even with AC, like you get distracted so quickly, you can't even. That's why when I wrote the book, I wanted to start in like chapter 7, jump to chapter 5, and then eventually go to chapter 1. Like any conversation you have,
totally
with somebody, yeah. So, like it's funny because I think people don't realize that it really is a challenge because I think these days, like it's everyone sort of like seems like they have it, but the truth is ADHD really stands out, like the hyperactivity disorder,
right?
Like you really know. When my mom finally took me to see somebody after I was doing some, like, weird drawings, he's like, okay, that's it, you know. This guy, like, I sat down and talked with him, and he had me eat, like, peanuts. He had me eat chocolate. He had me eat all these different things, and he was watching how I focused in the conversation. And so then he was explaining to me that he had it as well. Huh. But he was a professional psychiatrist in the whole nine yards. But I was blown away then because nobody wants to hear that you've got some type of mental challenge.
And how old were you at this point in that office?
I was like, I literally was already almost out of high school. I was like 17.
So I'd
like, already missed it. I'd already like, so all that knowledge had just gone out the window.
Right. But it's still a sensitive age to, you know, we're still trying to find our identity.
Right.
So then to get any type of diagnosis, you're like, fuck, man, I'm just trying to make it already. And now you're going to throw this on me.
And I think that's the biggest challenge with ADHD. What nobody talks about is the confidence that you don't have. Because my parents, yes, I was amusing because I was entertaining because I'm like always breaking something or like, you know, causing havoc or wearing my desk or, you know, running naked in the classroom. Yes, that's fun. But the truth is when I was mowing the lawn, they'd look out the window and they'd be like, oh my God, he's going to cut his foot off. And so, but if you have that kind of like, if that's how your family looks at you, like you don't go out in the world like, I'm going to nail my first job.
No.
So like, you know, it's like.
Were they helicopter parents?
No, they were jazz vodka and cigarette parents.
Got it.
You know what I mean? Like,
they were 70s parents.
Yeah, they're 70s parents.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Smoking in the house, you know.
Right.
Like,
exactly.
Not give it a shit.
Grab the kid, honey. I think it hit the floor.
Totally. Yeah. Shut the fuck up. I'm talking to Ty Pennington. The book is called Life to the Extreme, How a Chaotic Kid Became America's Favorite Carpenter. You do have some funny stories about, like, you know, your childhood.
Yes.
I mean, did you get kicked out of school?
Yes. Every school. So I was so bad in elementary school. Well, not only that, but I think the opening chapter, my mom goes to study the worst kid in this elementary school. And they're like, Mrs. Pennington, you really don't want to know who that is. But then like, and then I transferred to a different school. And then in that school, I was so bad, I had to stay in the hallway for just about most of the classes. And then they heard about me at the high school I was going to go to. So when I got to that high school, I absolutely sat in the hallway or the basically in the principal's office, which was interesting. So I got to know the staff at the high school better than anyone because I was always hanging out with them.
Right.
But there's some teachers back in the day, like, they would just be like, nope, I'm not dealing with that. You can. So, but it was just the way it was. So I would have to keep transferring to new schools where nobody knew me. And so.
That'd be hard.
It is. But when nobody knows your show yet, like, you actually can study. But then once they get to know, oh, dude, you got to see what this kid does.
Right.
Then all of a sudden, once they find out that you're, you know, you're funny, you get the idea.
So like, you got that. You maybe got confidence, too, of making the kids laugh.
Yes. Well, that was it. That's how I became, you know, so. And that's why I ended up, you know, in entertainment and juggling cats down in circuses. And no, I'm kidding. But, you know, you end up in the entertainment industry because that's what you're good at.
100%. I totally understand. Were you I'm not sure about back then when they tried to medicate. I know they tried Ritalin on a bunch of kids.
Oh, yeah. But back when I was being diagnosed, they didn't have it. They didn't even know what it was.
Right.
So they would put me on Benadryl. And so I would be drowsy and drooling. And they're like, Ty, you want to comment on the treaty of blah, blah, blah? And I'd be like, these guys got together and they signed a piece of paper. They're
oh
like,
my God.
Close? Anybody else?
So, I can't even imagine being drugged up trying to learn.
And then there's this other thing my mom created called the token economy system.
What?
Right? This is great. So if I'd have to go to class, talk about embarrassing. You have to go to class, and everybody knew you were doing this because you had to bring in a card. And if the teacher crossed out conduct, good, class participation, good, like, you know, whatever, that kind of thing, good, then you would, at the end of the week, if you were decent, you would get a prize.
Correct.
Well, my mom would go back into her closet and come out with some prize. Who knows what it was? Maybe a Pez candy dispenser. But once you've realized, I mean, I was fairly intuitive as a child. I'm like, you go into the closet. So when she wasn't in there, I went in there, found the bag, and I'm like, well, there goes that idea, because it's not that amazing,
no.
Mom. They're like Cracker Jacks, not that big of a surprise. So anyway, that went out the window. So, but yeah, it was never really, I never realized I sort of had something that could change. But once I did go see somebody at 17, and then I was medicated, oh my God, I was playing soccer in college, and up until that point, I've been sitting the bench, and my brother made varsity literally freshman year. We were both very good, but I went through a growing spurt that was just a little awkward to look at. It was like, God, you can't trap the ball anymore. What happened? So anyway, but then in college, I got medicated, and it was like somebody put a new focus ring on my camera.
Wow.
I could read the field. I started scoring hat tricks. Like, people were like, what is going on? I'm like, I'm focused, Beyonce's. So, yeah,
it made such a difference.
Huge, huge.
So then when did you learn, okay, I'm really good at building things?
Well, it wasn't just that. To be honest with you, what happened is a friend of mine's girlfriend said she got into this art school, and I was like, what do you mean you got into it? Well, I got a grant. And so her mom was cleaning houses, so she got a free ride. And I'm like, well, I'm looking into that. So anyway, I ended up, my parents made $2,000 too much or something. So long story short, I went to art school and realized that's what I was good at, because even my instructors were like, yo, this kid's good. And I was, of course, now I'm on medication. So instead of turning in one project, I was turning in three. And people were like, what is your problem? I was like, well, the first one was okay. And I figured the next one was all right. Then I did a combination of A and B, which is kind of what I do on the shows, Trading Spaces, too.
You
the
did.
First idea. And so anyway, that's when I realized I was good at something, was that. But here's the important point that I sort of make in the book. When you have ADHD, sometimes the people that you know the best, you have to get away from before you find yourself, because you're known as a certain person, and there's some personality and certain traits
right.
with them. But when you, I was asked to leave the house at 17, and it was probably the best thing that ever happened to me.
It wasn't at all a devastating scar.
No, the note, I was trying to find the note that my mom wrote me to put in the book.
No, that would be amazing.
But it was so good. But we did throw an amazing party. I was quite the MacGruber back then, too. So I knew I was being kicked out. So I threw a party and ran the hot water and the cold water from the washing machine to a baby pool on the deck. And so I had a hot tub. It's fantastic. It was a great party. I had a TV smashing room downstairs.
You can imagine
now why I was asked to leave.
Yeah, but I bet you were. You seem like you would have been a good time.
I was a great time. Yeah.
I'm talking to Ty Pennington. This book is called Life to the Extreme, How a Chaotic Kid Became America's Favorite Carpenter. But how did you go from being a model then to Trading Spaces?
Right. Well, that's where things get weird. What it was just coming out of my mom's womb, I was devastatingly handsome. And it was, they didn't know what to do with me. They just said, my God, we've got to get this child into fashion modeling. And I was actually, this is a pretty funny story. So I'm going to art school in Atlanta at night. I'm painting houses during the day. So I did a little bit of everything, but I ended up painting houses for a long time with a bunch of women called the Paint Hers, which is funny. I was the only paint him. Long story short, I'm skateboarding out in front of my place, and this dude comes up to me and goes, hey, man, I think I can make you some money. And I'm like, I bet you can. I don't really do that kind of work, but I appreciate the offer. But he hands me this card, and I never forget the name of the agency. It was called Serendipity. And so I walk into this agency, and I'm like, because I realized, like, I'm broke. I got to pay for art school. I'm like, anyway, let's not even bring up the IRS. It was just, things were looking rough.
Tough.
And so I walk in there, and I go, hey, this guy told me I could come in here and maybe get some work. And the lady looks at me and goes, what? Who said what? Is it? And like, so I had a rat tail. You know, the 80s were amazing.
No, I know.
And so they're like, have you seen yourself? And I'm like, look, I'm just asking you. This dude told me to come in here. So she's like, have you ever had any pictures taken of yourself? I was like, no. There's a picture of me and my brother.
My
but
God.
While I'm there, this Japanese guy is pointing at me and just laughing. And I'm like, what is his problem? So anyway, he was a scout. He comes out to me and I go, what is your deal? He's like, you should come to Japan. I'm like, why? He goes, you make money. And I'm like, really? I'm still listening. So out of nowhere, like, I was working at a graphic design firm. I think it just, no, not yet. Anyway, yes, I was. And but I told those guys, look, I'm leaving the country for a little bit. I'll be back. My stepdad, who was a musician but also a lawyer, read my contract. He goes, dude, you're going into child slavery. And I go, then it's settled. I'm going. And so it was just weird. There's like culture shock. I just went to see what would happen.
Right, and?
And it was amazing. Like, they knew I wasn't going to make any money, so they put me in the ghetto in Osaka, which is called Tennoji. It's where everybody has tats, and it's like, it's where the brothels are, the pachinko, the gambling area. So I'm like, here's this kid from Atlanta who's like living in like the Japanese ghetto. I'm like, this is so dope. Anyway, it changed my perspective of like life. So I came back to the graphic design studio. And by the way, those were the first bits of writing I did. I was so lonely in Japan. I'd write these notes that I'd send to the graphic design agency. And like, one of them was like, a man without a country without giblet gravy. There's just all these like stupid little
stories.
Yeah, they're like, I didn't know you could write. I'm like, well, don't check my spelling, but yes, I can write. So anyway, that opened up my mind to sort of just anything else. So the next thing I know, like 3 months later, I moved to New York City in the late 80s. And so I didn't know if I was ever going to be a male model because I looked like I was 8. I'm not kidding. Like, I didn't hit puberty till I was, I'm still waiting. And so I didn't do the kind of modeling that you make money in.
Right.
I was like all that weird stuff. But I went on these auditions for commercials, and like the first month I was in New York City, I landed 4 commercials, and I'm like, what is going on? So then I asked the guys, like, why did you guys hire me? Like, again, he goes, you know, the director said you seem to make everybody else look good. And I go, what?
What?
He goes, I'm a fluffer? And he's like, well, yeah, I guess you could say that. And so I realized I made other people comfortable on camera. And they're like, though everybody else looks better. And so, like, even in modeling, I'd be the guy in the background blurred out anyway. So
that's,
I guess what I'm saying
is
all these different random sort of things I was doing, where I didn't realize it at the time, but it was gaining experience. Like, so when somebody, like at the audition of Trading Spaces, I was just comfortable being in front of a camera. I don't know.
And
I made everybody else comfortable. And
you were perfect for it. And
I guess.
And then you did said that Trading Spaces was the best job you ever had.
Yes.
And did you leave?
That I walked away from.
That you walked away from.
Yeah.
Did you walk away from it for Extreme Home, or did you just walk away from because you thought?
I wish I knew I had a job. No, it was just one of those things where, like, I love that job, but there was 2 carpenters, and so I was only working half the episodes, and I was like, yo, like, I'm, like, losing money because I took your job because I can't help out the other clients I was working on. They're like, yeah, we understand that, but this, you know, this is really all we can do. And I'm like, is there another show you could put me on? Like I will work 2 other television shows for you. They're like, nah, we kind of like you right where you are. I'm like, wow, so you're really leaving me no choice? So anyway, it was just one of those things. And so, yeah, I mean, mostly I've been fired from every job I have. It's rare that I walk away from, you know, an income. But
you know, those to me, taking those kinds of leaps and risks,
you have to.
Yeah. They have the greatest reward.
But it's so hard to walk away from, like, I mean, that was like a gravy train.
Right?
Like, dude, how'd you get a job being you? I'm like, I was qualified.
But now there's proof, you know
right.
what I mean? I mean, in hindsight, we can always look back and go, wow, look how everything led perfectly to each other when one door closed, the window
right.
opened, da-da-da-da-da.
True.
It's like the universe always has our back. I love this book so much, and I know our audience wants this so much, this perspective of what it feels like all of our
kids.
This
unfocused perspective.
But I love it. It's candid, it's funny, and it's just, and it's a happy ending.
Which we always love.
We do. Some maybe more than others. Ty Pennington, Life to the Extreme, How a Chaotic Kid Became America's Favorite Carpenter. Pick it up now. Is there going to be TV for you in the future?
Yes. Well, I'm on Trading Spaces literally like Saturday. So they brought back the reboot.
Nice.
But I'm a designer now on that one, which is fun. But I designed this country room that's actually really beautiful. But they said they wanted to go extreme on it. And I'm like, okay. So without any of the producers of the network knowing, I actually rented farm animals and put them in these.
Shut up.
And wait till you see what they did, and I mean the farm animals, on this beautiful blanket bedspread that I made for these guys out of denim blue jeans. Oh, they were the shock and horror. He was filming it, and it's literally the camera is shaking because the cameramen are laughing so hard.
What is this airing so we can
Saturday night 8 o'clock on TLC.
Oh my god, I can't wait, and I love that you're a designer now. You should be front and center.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Ty Pennington, thank you for this book, Life to the Extreme. Pick it up now. Come back anytime. Congratulations.
Thank you.
We'll be right back, guys.
Jenny McCarthy Show.
Oh!